graduating from law school, and I'm very thankful that I was invited here to share with you whatever experience I may have in the regulation in the power industry. There. All right. So the Philippine electricity market prior to IPIRA will have this structure for the generation. The generation is primarily that of NAPOCOR, or the National Power Corporation, state-owned. At the same time, the state-owned is the owner of the transmission asset, meaning the high voltage wires that through which the power generated from the plants will be delivered to the distribution network of our distribution utilities. So for the generation and transmission, since this is a state-owned regulation, is in terms of the approval by the board of the National Power Corporation of whatever rates that it will implement and impose on its customers. So basically, that's just that. But of course, there is a provision there where the decision of the NAPOCOR board can be elevated to the regulator. At the time, we had the Public Service Commission, then the Board of Energy, Energy Regulatory Board, until the Energy Regulatory Board. So that was the sector regulator for power. Then for the distribution, you have already the private distribution utilities like Meralco, and also the various electric cooperatives. Mainly the urban centers were served by the private or the investor-owned power utilities or companies, while the provinces, the rural areas, since there was not much interest then to invest in these areas, basically the distribution was developed through the creation of these electric cooperatives, and mostly supported by government through subsidies in terms of their operating requirements. And then, of course, power is delivered to the end consumers. And prior to law restructuring, everyone is considered what we call the captive customers, meaning you and I, we are captive customers of the distribution utility where we are connected. So the distribution utility where we are connected, of course, will depend on where we are. So that is the setup. There's no choice when we say connect with the Meralco. We will be charged by whatever Meralco will charge us. But Meralco, of course, being a regulated entity, and at the time, Meralco, as a distribution utility, as well as other distribution utilities, they're regulated by the Energy Regulatory Board. That's the predecessor board of the ERC, the present Energy Regulatory Commission. Then we had the Electric Power Industry Reform Act in 2001. So the intention of the law was to restructure the power industry. Remember, before 2001, government was heavily indebted because National Power Corporation is state-owned. Although it has the ability to set its rates, but being a state-owned, of course, government, because prices of electricity, they're political. Any increase may have some political implications. So the rates of NAPOCOR may not have been sufficient at the time for it to be able to recover its expenses. At the same time, if you remember, before 2001, we experienced a lot of brownouts or blackouts due to deficiency in supply. NAPOCOR, even if it's a state-owned, wasn't able to keep up with the increasing demand for power. At the same time, we have that decision made by government not to deploy or make use or operate the Bataan nuclear power plant. So, faced with that crisis, of course, before IPIRA, we enticed already the independent power producers to enter the generation field. But there are just few of them, and they were enticed because of the power purchase agreements that government through NAPOCOR entered into for investments coming from the IPPs to pour in. So there will be new capacities built right away to address the shortage. So because of these IPPs, of course, they will have to be paid. And even if the capacities were no longer needed at a certain point in time, they would still have to be paid because of the contractual obligation under the PPAs. So government was paying or obliged to pay the loans or the debts or the obligation to the IPPs. So at the time, it's come to a point that may not have been anymore sustainable for government to continue doing that. Plus, there were reforms happening all over where the power industry was being restructured and open to competition. So that was what we decided when in 2001 Congress passed electricity or EPIRA. And with EPIRA was the restructuring. And the restructuring actually entailed identifying the four sectors in the power industry. Remember, prior to the EPIRA, generation and transmission were with the NAPOCOR, distribution was with the distribution utilities, and the distribution utilities were also the ones supplying power to the end consumers. With the restructuring, four sectors were identified, or the power industry was divided into the four sectors of generation, transmission, distribution, and supply. The objective was to identify of these four sectors, which sectors can be open to competition. And for generation, that was the decision to open it to competition. And in fact, not just opening it to competition, government has decided it's high time for the government or NAPOCOR to step out of that field and just concentrate on providing missionary electrification in the spot areas. And so, together with the restructuring, the opening of certain sectors of the power industry to competition, you have also the decision of government to privatize the assets and contracts of National Power Corporation. The idea being that if the assets of NAPOCOR and the contracts were sold to different players, there would be more players in the generation sector. So that will be the start of having competition in generation. So generation, open and competitive. Transmission was carved out of NAPOCOR. The assets were placed in the hands of the National Transmission Corporation, or TANSCO. But there was also a provision in EPIRA for the privatization of the transmission function. And government has decided that the way to do it was through a concession agreement. And so, after TANSCO operated the transmission company, then it bidded out the concessionaire for this transmission function. And right now, we have the National Grid Corporation of the Philippines. The transmission is the backbone. It's like the highway for electricity. And so, there's only one provider of this transmission highway. And since there are no other players, government has decided to retain this as a regulated sector. Meaning, since there's only one provider of the service, and there's a regulator, the rate regulator being the Energy Regulatory Commission under the restructured power industry, the rates and the services or compliance of the transmission operator to the performance standards will have to be checked, will have to be set, the rates will have to be set by the regulator, the performance will have to be also monitored. Then, the distribution, there was no change in the distribution. Still had Oh, before the distribution, under IPIRA also, to support the investment in generation, to have also competition. Aside from the privatization, the law set up or established the wholesale electricity spot market. Right now, it is being operated by the Philippine Electricity Market Corporation, where I am connected. So the wholesale electricity spot market actually is part of generation, but it provides the platform or the opportunity for the generators to trade and for the buyers, the distribution utilities, to buy from the market outside of their contracts, because as distribution utilities, they also have that option of just contracting bilaterally direct with the generators. Then you have the distribution utilities. There was not much change in the law. And then for the supply, since there is already competition in the wholesale, at the wholesale level, the law also provided for competition at the retail level, meaning the distribution lines, they will continue to be operated by the distribution utilities. But these are the side streets. If transmission is the national highway, you have the side streets still being to be operated by the distribution utilities. But what will pass through these side streets, the electricity, the energy, can actually be supplied not necessarily by the distribution utility entering into bilateral contracts or buying from the WESM on behalf of the captive customers. The captive customers can actually decide to source their own power using, of course, the distribution network as the distribution network for that power that they will buy direct from the generator, acting as a supplier. So supply was also open to competition. And depending on the stage, right now we're in the 1 megawatt and up stage. So all these end users with demand of 1 megawatt and up, they can actually already contract directly with suppliers, with licensed suppliers, duly licensed by the ERC. Until there. This is the regulatory framework under IPIRA. I've mentioned already about ERC, the regulator. But side by side with that regulator, you need the policymaker, the implementer of policy, and that is the Department of Energy. The Department of Energy is a separate entity, and the ERC is a separate entity. I would always be asked when I was still with ERC, so us, you're under DOE. No, we are not. The ERC is an independent body. In fact, as declared in the IPIRA, it should be a strong and independent regulator composed of 5 members. But this is basically the framework. The policy implementer, the DOE, would come out with circulars, with approval of the plans, the power development plan, and it is expected that the regulator, through the regulation that it will issue or through the decisions that it will render in the cases or applications filed before it, will have to take into account or align its regulations, its actions with the policy as will be enunciated by the Department of Energy through the various instruments that it issues, like department circulars. Then the key actors here would be the different agencies and the stakeholders involved in the power industry. And I've mentioned already that there are the sectors that are competitive, there are those that are regulated. And so you have here the various actors. I've mentioned here also the National Electrification Administration, or NEA, because the electric cooperatives, since they're not up to par in terms of service deliveries to to other privately owned distribution utilities, there's need for some sort of support or supervision, and also to keep in check the various boards of these electric cooperatives. So we have a strengthened NEA. There was just a law that was passed to, in fact, even expand the powers of NEA to include the step-in powers for those electric cooperatives that may be in trouble. For the competitive sectors, the actors there, the generators, the IPPAs or the administrators, for those that bought into the IPP contracts of NAPUCOR, while they're not regulated by the ERC in terms of rate setting, actually there's still some form of regulation still. You have the requirement in the law for them to secure a certificate of compliance or a license before they can commercially operate. It's a license applied for with the ERC. The suppliers, those that provide service in the supply sector, they're also required to secure a license from the ERC. So there's a regulation even for those engaged in the competitive sectors of the power industry. I got this from the OECD, and basically these are the principles that I wanted to use to assess what we have in the Philippines in terms of the regulatory framework. And there was even the OECD report actually further cites 7 principles for the governance of regulators: role clarity, preventing undue influence, decision-making and governing board structure for independent regulators, accountability and transparency, engagement, funding, performance evaluation. So against these principles, I wanted to check what we have in the Philippines, and then I went into the law and how it is actually set up right now. So under EPIRA, the ERC's mandates as regulator are defined. It is not a single regulator, but a 5-member collegial body, which by law can come out with decisions and actions as a collegial body upon a majority vote. It is given autonomy from DOE, and politically, it is expected to act independently. Its members are required to divest any conflicting interests upon assumption to office, and they have requirements to observe even after they finish their terms. To enhance ERC's independence, its members are appointed with fixed terms of 7 years, and they cannot be removed except for cause. They are required to come from certain professions. The chairman must be a lawyer, one other member must also be a lawyer, and another must be an accountant, while others can come from other fields like engineering, economics, and finance. The ERC is exempt from salary standardization, and its members become entitled to retirement benefits after serving their 7-year terms. The ERC is granted quasi-judicial and rulemaking powers, which it exercises subject to observance of certain requirements, among them due process. As such, all filings and matters with ERC are duly noticed. Hearings are open to the public, recorded, and the ERC's decisions are required to be duly supported by substantial evidence. Decisions are subject to judicial review, and the ERC's performance is reported annually to Congress and scrutinized in the budget approval process for the agency. Further, a joint Congressional Power Commission composed of representatives from both houses of Congress is created to oversee the law's implementation and monitor the ERC's performance and compliance to the mandates and timelines set therein. So in short, we have actually the good governance features and safeguards in the law. We have role clarity, mandate of ERC is defined. You have preventing undue influence, maintaining trust. There's supposed to be independence from the DOE, independence from Congress, but then there is monitoring, so there is accountability and transparency in terms of open hearings requirement, requirements of due process, etc. So these are the sectoral functions, the specific functions of ERC for the different sectors. So this will just be my last slide. The ERC has been in the news lately. There were moves in Congress a few months back to abolish it. There was a proposal in the Senate to reform it by requiring it to adopt certain processes and practices to promote good governance. The challenge for ERC is how it can project itself to be the strong and independent regulator envisioned in the IPIRA, even as it strives to fulfill its main tasks to promote competition, encourage market development, and enforce regulations in the restructured electricity market, it is met by an increasingly disapproving public. Being formerly with ERC, I can definitely relate. And drawing from this experience, these are the qualities that I think every regulator should possess. At this critical juncture, where competition and among private stakeholders is already happening in both the wholesale and retail electricity markets, whatever may have been said about the ERC as an institution matters more now. The ERC is central to building an enabling environment for private initiatives, one that ensures that the benefits trickle down to electricity consumers and society at large. A regulatory environment that is capable of delivering the promises of Republic Act No. 9136 or the APRA. Thank you and good morning.